My name is Eric Van Horn. I bought my first franchise in my 20s, and since then, I've owned 6 brands with 25 stores in 8 states. I've also helped 1,000 people find the right franchise for them. People like us who are not cut out for the 9-to-5 and like to work smarter, not harder. How do we find the right franchise, buy it, grow it, sell it, and how do we do it in a way to own the business without it owning us? Those are the questions, and I'm on a mission to give you the answers. Welcome to Franchise Secrets. Welcome to the Franchise Secrets podcast with your host, Eric Van Horn, and today's guest is Dennis Morton. Now, Dennis is a wealth manager for franchisees in McDonald's, among other families and business owners. But I wanted to bring him on today to talk about wealth management, and probably a lot of that has to do with some asset protection and things like that too. We could talk about that as well. But I thought it was fascinating to get somebody that's deep into a mature system like McDonald's that's working with these big, large brick and mortar franchisees that I'm assuming have done pretty well over the years. And so, and then I wanted to stream this live on Facebook because there's a lot of people that I think could get some value out of this. If you're listening to this on Facebook right now, why don't you jump in, and you are a franchisee, jump into my Facebook group. Just go to franchisetribe.com, franchisetribe.com, and you can get into my private Facebook group where I do recordings and things like this, specifically in that group. Dennis, why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself, and welcome to the show.
Thank you. Much appreciated. Good to be here, Eric. So I'm the co-founder and principal of Morton Brown Family Wealth. We're an independent fiduciary wealth management firm. We're based out of Allentown, Pennsylvania. And we were founded in 2018, but my partner and I have been working together for the better part of a decade. We're both certified financial planners, so our expertise is on everything from retirement planning, investing, estate planning, taxation, insurance, kind of the full gamut of wealth management for individuals and families. So for about 15 years, we've had the privilege of working with a number of McDonald's franchisees, both in the lead up to transitioning out of their franchise experience, and then also navigating the years afterwards and kind of adopting some good principles around living their best life in retirement.
When did the majority of these McDonald's franchisees actually get started? So are most of them in retirement age right now trying to transition, or is it a mixture of, like, are you working with the old ones and the new ones, or just the old ones kind of exiting?
Right. So we have a good mix of them. Actually, it's three tiers right now, because McDonald's is such a multi-generational business that we have some post-retirees who've been out of the system for some time. We have some who are currently planning, and then there are others who are trying to bring in their next gen, and we're helping the next generation also think about what financial decisions they can make to set themselves up in a way that might be a little bit different from what mom and dad did.
Now, I think that's interesting, because as people work with me, they want to buy franchises. A lot of people are in that retirement age. They didn't start a McDonald's probably, or any franchise, when they should have. They're looking ahead, and they're like, I'm going to retire in 10 to 20 years. I don't have anything to pass on to my kids. They don't have not going to pass on a 401k. They don't have a business, and they're wishing they were like your current clients at McDonald's. So what is the mindset of a McDonald's owner right now? Like, is someone that's wanting to transition? What does the family dynamics look like? Because I want to paint the picture for those that haven't thought about this, of what their mindset's going to look like when they do have a business that they can transition to family.
I think it's what we've heard recently. We just went through a long process of interviewing all of our existing McDonald's clients and relationships to ask them just that question. What are the things that are top of mind for you? And for many of them, if they don't have a next gen in place and a transition in place, they're really thinking about how their retirement date isn't necessarily up to them. That there are going to be a lot of other factors where they're looking at some of their peers who, you know, if they're in their 60s, some of their peers are saying, I'm deciding to step away at this point. And when you're in the McDonald's ecosystem, that decision isn't necessarily yours to make. There's going to be external factors at play. You know, you have to work on the corporate initiatives and when the right timing is going to be. So you really have to think in 3-to-5-year increments. So accepting that and knowing that going in, that it's not necessarily going to be at your discretion. The flip side to that, though, is done right, you can build in so much freedom that it can be a really nice business to be in. I think the bottom line is appreciating that your exit from the franchise model might not necessarily be as on your terms as a traditional career. And if you're willing to accept that, you can gain a lot of freedom but you might be losing a little bit of your own timeline in the decision-making on your final retirement date.
Let's just jump right into where we are today with coronavirus. And it's just throwing every, I mean, the market's up right now, like 8%, but it's been down like 30 plus percent recently. So we are right now a week after quarantines kind of came into play. So everyone in live on Facebook's like, yeah, Eric, no kidding. But as people listen to this podcast later, I want to give context. So where we are, because it's a fluid situation. What, like, give us some context into, from your perspective on the QSR space and businesses like McDonald's, what are they thinking about now? What are they going through? Is it business as usual because they've got the drive-throughs, or what are they dealing with?
The experience is really running the gamut right now. We've been checking in with our owner operators, and for some of them, their stores are completely shut down because they might be close to an airport or a shopping mall where there's no traffic. They might have others that are maybe down 40 to 60%. Others are actually doing, have been doing pretty well right up until now. But as you said, the situation is changing week to week. They're on calls every week with corporate just to make sure that they're being given the amount of guidance and latitude. One of the big things is just making sure that there's a lot of reinvestment that happens in these McDonald's stores and a lot of initiatives that are in place. How do we manage the debt loads? How do we make sure that cash is sufficient? And I think that's where the real emphasis is right now. But also, it's the health of their teams. You know, these are large employers that have to worry about how to keep people healthy, how to keep the stores going to the best of their ability. So
give some context into the owner that has 15 stores. Like, what size of team do they have? What are they thinking about right now? What's that team size?
I think the team size is really going to change. I mean, it's going to be, you know, as far, it's going to run the gamut, because some of these stores, if they're small, mostly drive-through operations like an airport store, it's probably shut down. But if you're getting larger operations, they're trying to figure out right now what the layoff situation is going to look like. One operator told me last week that one of the things he's most happy about right now is that they do have a powerful brand behind them advocating on the employment side, because employment law is going to change so much in the short term regarding this, and they don't know how. But at least having a seat at the table with you know, the leadership of McDonald's sitting with government officials and saying, this is what the impact is going to be, it gives them a little bit of confidence that whatever the result is, they can handle it.
What calls are you getting from these franchisees right now as a wealth manager for them in different transitions? Like, what are they calling, asking you about?
So one of the things that we've encouraged our owner operators to do is, as they start managing their debt loads from investment and they get ramped up into the system, start to set aside a little bit in savings and building up your liquidity outside of the restaurants. That's really going to give you a lot of decision stability later on as you approach retirement. So some of them, we're talking to them about, okay, let's slow down the contributions into your bank account, into your brokerage account, and we can stem that for a little bit because we need to shore up what you have in cash in the business. So a lot of it's making sure that over and above your cash ratios in your McDonald's stores in the operation, that we've made sure that we're pulling the right levers at the right time. I haven't gotten a sense of panic. I just think there's a great sense of leadership, actually. That's the really compelling part. And among all of them, there's some great leaders in the franchise space, and they're really in full leadership mode right now, making sure they're making the right decisions at the right times.
I love that you said they're not in panic mode. I talked to a lot of franchisees that are in panic mode, but most of them are new business owners, and or they haven't been through a downturn or a recession or some type of turmoil. And that's why I started that Facebook group, the Franchise Tribe. Because I wanted to, and that's not why I started it, to help people grow and scale. But now I'm in there helping people, you know, navigate this, because I'm around people that are leaders. I'm around franchisees and just other people that have this mindset that we know it's going to come to an end. There's an end to this. We don't know exactly when it's going to be, but this isn't a downward spiral that's going to last forever. There's going to be a point when it peaks or stops going down, then that's going to start going up again. And it's going to, you know, it's not going to be a straight line, but we know the long-term play, and that, and those of us that are in business know that there's going to be opportunity to grow and scale, and it's going to look different than it was before. But I love like the people that you're working with, and you work with a significant amount of, in my opinion, a significant amount of McDonald's, smaller and larger franchisees. You didn't hesitate. You said they're not freaking out. They are making decisions and they're getting liquid. So what does that liquidity look like? I know for me, it's been, I looked at my lines of credit. I asked them to increase. I even pulled out money on some of my lines to maintain liquidity. And then I've just made sure I've had extra reserves in different banks and different institutions. So that's been my process. What are you specifically telling them, or what would you tell a franchisee right now to get as liquid as possible? Like, get tactical with me.
Right. So McDonald's has pretty stringent requirements on the cash ratios and the amount that you have relative to your debt load. So each one is going to be different. And we work closely with the other members of their team, so their accountants, their attorneys, and their consultants, to make sure that they're compliant with the McDonald's requirements. But then over above that, what do they need to do to potentially backstop that? So there's always a question of how much to keep in the business, how much to take out. At times like this, fortunately, they hit that first stage of defense, which is their ratios that they have to keep in the business. And then over and above that, we're saying, what is the right risk level outside of that? And everyone's different when they think about, this is what you find out on a risk spectrum. We joke that, you know, in normal times, you ask people on a scale of 1 to 10, how risky are you? And most people will say they're a 4 to a 6. Well, you find out who your 2s and 3s are right now, because they're ones who might have been a little bit too out over their skis. But for the most part, having that first, even if it's not an established protocol like it would be in a McDonald's system, having just that first tier of cash, it's not going to grow. It's not going to help. It's not going to accomplish a lot for you. It's just that safety net set aside. Mm-hmm. So, and then we start talking about, all right, what are the implications on the family? What if we have to go without a draw for a little bit? Are we still able to accomplish what we thought we were going to accomplish?
So McDonald's franchisees are, I think, different than others with the real estate. Who owns the real estate that the McDonald's location's on?
That's McDonald's.
McDonald's. And that's, yeah. I mean, that's their story, right? I mean, yes. Everyone says they're not in the burger flipping business. They're in the real estate business as McDonald's right. Corporate. So McDonald's corporate owns that. So they can't go, like, that's their landlord is McDonald's
correct.
Corporate. So they're not going to go the typical route asking them for relief. McDonald's corporate gets to decide if they do that or don't do that.
Correct. Yeah, there's going to be, I think right now there's rent relief that's in place. So there's going to be a little bit of rent relief. Service fees are going to come down because those are percentages. But, you know, the rent relief is a big matter for them and top of mind. Other than that, it's a matter of maintaining sales and trying to achieve what they can with the drive-through model and having a walk-up curbside model. They're still able to function maybe better than a lot of other restaurant models might be able to.
So I was around some franchisors last week when I was skiing in Park City, or a week and a half ago. And I was visiting with some franchisors there, and they'd already started looking. This is before just right after the NBA announced, like, we're not doing any more games. And,
right.
And that's when it really hit a lot of us, like, wow, this is serious. That morning, I was listening to some franchisors talk about their supply chains, because they're getting supplies from different parts of the country. And they said, we've already adjusted our supply chains. We started to change where we were getting stuff, so mm-hmm. we're not going to be vulnerable in the second, third, and fourth quarter. And I thought, wow, these guys are ahead of where I am. Why am I not thinking that? What have you seen globally from McDonald's, like, that you... the information that you're getting from the franchisees, you're like, wow, these guys are on top of it. These guys were thinking ahead.
Right. And that's what I think, coming out of some of the calls that McDonald's held last week, our sense of the way they conveyed stability was that the supply chain was intact. I mean, that was the first thing when McDonald's came out with any public announcements last week for updates. The first thing they emphasized was the supply chain is intact. That gave the operators mm-hmm. a lot of confidence. It said, okay, like, you use the word tactical. We can afford to be very tactical here because we know the strategic piece was in place well in advance. So they feel pretty good about that. That being said, this is as fluid a business situation as many of us will ever see in our careers. So I think I can't tell, even just in the last 2 weeks, we've noticed in one area you feel really prepared. The next day it catches you off guard, and then you're back to being prepared the next day. So I think that's where the ability to, that humility to control what you can control in the moment. But being able to trust the strategic steps were taking place beforehand is really important.
what are some of the younger generation seeing through this? Because, you know, the people that are coming into that, what does that look like in a transition? So is it like, how old are some of these younger ones coming in to take over locations from their parents or maybe their grandparents?
Right. So they'll typically be in their late 20s to early 30s. I mean, it's the next generation process and becoming a franchisee is pretty stringent in that regard. But we're
stringent from the franchisor has a because McDonald's is super stringent. Like franchisees listening to this, I think, you know, I have people that I know that own McDonald's, and it's not like you just go and apply and you can own a McDonald's. There's a period of working there, and it's kind of like you almost have to be asked to come in some ways.
That process takes years, and I think that any business right now is concerned about succession for the most part. That's going to be a big story in our economy over the next so many years, and McDonald's is no different. And finding your next generation, if your children want to be in the business, then there's the lead time to getting in. But then there's the finding the avenues to success, because one of the trends within the McDonald's ecosystem has been larger multi-store operators. You know, the two, three, five store operators are kind of merging up into larger organizations. And that changes the opportunity set for the next gen coming in. So I'll be curious coming out of this disruption, what they're learning from this, what it does to that trend that was in place, and what it means for their opportunities to acquire stores as they become licensed operators.
Succession planning for a family that has kids that are ready to do that and want to do that. What happens to the person that's a franchisee and they don't have kids, or their kids want to do something else and they don't want to be the McDonald's franchisee? Who do you see as stepping in? My guess would be that it's another owner that's wrapping that into their current portfolio. Is there something else that I'm not seeing?
No, the geography matters, of course. This is a trend that's been going on for the better part of a decade. So there will be, it's as if the operators that are committed to growing by acquisition are separated out from the operators that are relatively staying pat. And you're just seeing more of a disparity between the two. But if you don't have an internal succession plan, you know, there's the relationships that are formed to your right and to your left in your geographic area. And there's usually one or two organizations that are being very acquisitive. It's just a matter of timeline and price and all those matters coming up.
So as you are looking at customers, possible people working with you, they have, you know, they probably have a portfolio of businesses. They might have a handful of businesses, probably be worth, you know, a couple million dollars on up. And that's probably the ideal candidate for you to be working with, have some type of liquidity. And they're wanting to do something. Is it they're wanting to, like, as you look at their overall financial picture, is it more protecting what they have? Is it growing? What's the balance between the two?
It's usually about protecting first, because the growth has happened. But here's where the blind spots come in sometimes, is they have a hard time envisioning what it looks like on the other side. So if we draw up their balance sheet and show that you have your McDonald's stores, you have a series of maybe some real estate investments, a couple of, 401k over here, it's just it's kind of accumulated over time, but not very purposeful. Then we say, all right, what if we remove the McDonald's stores? What if you sell your primary residence and things start shifting around? What does that look like on the other side? And you sense the uncertainty, especially in a case, I mean, McDonald's, in some cases, you'll have a husband and wife who are both owner operators, but many times it's just one spouse. And when it's the case that it's one spouse, then it becomes, okay, we've understood for years that our wealth has come from this place, from owning these stores, from owning this business. Take that out of the picture, and can you communicate to your spouse where this is all going to come from now? Because it's a big departure, and a lot of that, sometimes that can act as a hurdle to getting into the planning conversation in the first place.
So let's say someone is ready to go that route. They are transitioning out of active ownership, and they're wanting, what I hear you saying is they're needing passive income streams. Their net worth is now going from McDonald's into other passive income streams. And I'm sure they sometimes still own part of the McDonald's portfolio as it transitions?
If it's a family transition, yes. They'll oftentimes phase that in, sell a couple of their stores, hold on to a few others, and that'll be a part of a planned transition. But if it's a transaction to a third party, they'll sell the whole portfolio of stores for the most part.
So the portfolio sold, where do you go to? Like, what's your go-to investments for them to have that passive income?
Right. So the first thing we do is emphasize liquidity. So there's, you know, you talk about that preservation mindset. Oftentimes it's just find me one thing that's going to protect it all and give me some kind of guarantee. But that's part of the challenge of today's environment. Guarantees are very costly. If you want your money safe, you're not going to earn very much. I mean, that this, we're back to interest rates at zero. So we try and talk them through about how it has to be a balance between income and growth and what their unique risks are, because that was another thing we heard in our feedback from owner operators, is that they often look to their right and to their left and they realize how different they are from their peers. That our situation, because we have kids, because we live a certain lifestyle, we're not like that person over there. So how do we plan for us? Because they can't benchmark very easily among their peers.
Why not? Like, you would think that there would be that benchmarking among peers in a similar system like that. What's different? What are the major differences?
I think first of all, we hear that there's not a lot of conversation around personal finance. They talk a lot about their commonality, which is in the operations of the stores and the consistent brand and all of their common experience through various stages of growth for McDonald's. But they all live very different lifestyles. So, you know, someone might be told over a beer by their buddy that you're going to need $3 or $4 million just to live a healthy lifestyle. And they'll come to us in a panic and say, that's their life. That's not your life. And let's make sure we right size this. So it's a matter of taking the franchise environment can be very standardized. The financial planning environment is highly customized. And that's what we try and emphasize to them is let's talk very customized to you in your situation, because we're moving away from the standardization.
Let's talk some tax strategies with that.
Sure.
So when you go to, that's one of the nice things when you're planning a sale like that, you have your tax strategy in place versus with family. And then I'm guessing if it is to a third party, then there's probably greater tax consequences because they're kind of opposed, right?
Right. Yeah. Well, and also you're not doing it as piecemeal, that you can say, we're going to space this out over time, but you're doing it wholesale. And I think there can be tax consequences, but one of my favorite tax professionals always says, don't let the tax tail wag the investment dog. And that's where we want to make sure that yes, you are going to pay taxes on this and they're going to be at a certain level, but let's look at your net number and make sure that you know how that net number is sufficient. If you have the confidence, you know, after taxes that you can accomplish this, then let's make a plan off of that. Another thing about taxation, this comes back to how you get the safety. What kind of investment vehicles do you use? You've been in a high tax bracket probably for a good many years running your stores. Now you may be in a completely different situation, and we help them to understand we don't need to be as tax efficient as we used to be because your situation just changed dramatically with that transaction.
Yeah. And so when you're going through that, do you set up some things to where you can put money aside in different investment vehicles when you're in that higher tax bracket? Because especially when you're coming to a certain age where you can start taking money out at a lower tax bracket. I think pension plans, right? I've got pension plans that I've set up. So I'm putting money into it, basically tax deferred. You probably know more than this. I'm tax deferred. So I'm not paying taxes on that now. Put a significant amount in there, tax deferred until I'm a certain age. I think, what is it? 60 something?
At age 72, you have to start taking 72. It out.
I was hoping it was 60 something. I have to wait till I'm 72 now. But at that point, I get to, I'm at a lower tax bracket. So I'm taking it out at a lower tax bracket. But when you're dealing with somebody that is 60 and they are still earning a lot of income, are you setting up plans like that? Is that part of the strategy?
It is. And actually, this is another, the recent turmoil due to the virus is one situation that's changed. But even at the beginning of this year, the government passed what's called the Secure Act, which was a lot of changes designed for small businesses to help them set up what we call tax qualified plans, like simple IRA plans, 401ks, and allowing them to get their employees to put away more money and for the owners to put away more money. So we were just getting our arms around the implications of that for planning. In fact, we're getting ready to do a webinar tomorrow on that very topic, but then throw in the mix of market volatility and everything else. That's part of the challenge is you plan for the investments and your personal situation, but you also have to live in the environment that exists and all the rules on contributions, distributions, and taxes.
Let's talk about teams, because I think smart, successful business people have a team around them. And you alluded to it, you know, your CPA, your wealth advisor, your attorney. And I've been talking to all of them the last couple of weeks. I mean, they've, you know, they're favorites in my phone right now because I've got this team that I, because everything kind of insurance, it all kind of works together. What do you see as a successful team around a successful franchisee?
I think it has a lot to do with where their accountability is. So for example, we've seen, we've worked closely with some of the accountants that service the McDonald's community over time. And their great role is as both business advisors and compliance experts. They're, if you're going to live in a very standardized system, somebody has to be telling you, you know, flashing the red light when you're going off the rails and nudging you back on. And I think that level of accountability and understanding of what it means to be living in your environment, that's so valuable. Same thing with the attorneys. What we found, interestingly on the financial planning side, which is, I think, an opportunity for firms like ours, is that oftentimes there isn't that same accountability to the business owner and his or her family. That when you're living in McDonald's world and you, you have those good professionals keeping you compliant and succeeding in there, but then the minute you step away from that, suddenly there is no structure. There is no system to stay compliant with. So as one of the accountants put it, who's flashing the red light when you're now 65 or 70 years old and have all of these decisions to make, and who's kind of nudging you and keeping you on track? I think that's a role where a fiduciary advisor can really step in and take on that responsibility, help you determine where am I growing, where am I earning income, and how does this all last me throughout the rest of my life?
So how many of these franchisees are kind of nervous about their kids taking over? Or have they, the kids grown up in the business enough where they grew up in a wealthy family and they still had work ethic? They didn't grow up entitled, or they had, you know, that's I always wonder about that. And I, my kids are too young for that right now, but I think about that. So what have you seen with the owners, kind of the, you know, both sides of that?
So I hear less concern about their ability to take over, because that having that vetting process and those high hurdles to get over just to become an approved operator is very helpful from the parent's perspective. It's almost, it is third party validation that not just my kid's great because they're my kid, my kid's done really well relative to others coming in from outside. What I hear more often than that is, are they going to be living in the same environment that we did over the last 25 years? The conditions that defined our success, are they going to be the same conditions that are present for them? And now, granted, that's always something that we worry about for our kids, but it's especially true with dining and service habits changing very dramatically. I think one of the outcomes from the current crisis is that we talk about creative destruction that changes businesses materially. I think this could be one of the fastest periods of creative destruction that we've seen in generations, and it's going to change people's habits. So I'm sure as we talk more and more through this with operators who have next generation plans, what environment are their children inheriting if they take over the business?
What are these franchisees, what else do they own? What other businesses or what type of real estate are they in? Like I own some, you know, I've owned single family homes. I'm involved with retail concepts and hotels right now, which is not the greatest thing to do. So right now it was last year, but right now, and I think that the hotels and that type of stuff will come back. But what other businesses do McDonald's franchisees own, or are they only allowed to own and operate McDonald's?
No, they do have some other businesses and some other moving parts. There's a lot of real estate because I think they do see that as being a shortfall in their own business model that they don't own the real estate that their stores are on. So you'll see a lot of commercial real estate, own office properties. That's the most frequent thing that we see. But then there are also localized opportunities. So you'll see them going into business partnerships in their local communities with friends. I mean, it's almost a little bit of a contrast to a top-down corporate model that you'd be in something more entrepreneurial. you just get the sense that they try and round out the diversity of their portfolio, but not a lot in other restaurants. We have seen some do invest in hotels or other restaurant experiences after retirement, just as a way of staying in the game in that respect in hospitality.
Yeah. What are some of the other investments that you see as like that, anybody that's retired? Because I know you work beyond just with franchisees in right. McDonald's, and you work with right. other families to help them manage their wealth. What are some of the investment opportunities that you see coming up, given this whole virus thing that might sure. be on the horizon?
So the great thing about investing in the world of today is that it's so democratized. If you want access to a particular market or a particular type of investment, there's any number of ways to accomplish it, whether it's through traditional investing through funds or indexes, or whether it's through private equity, or there's just been an increased amount of access to do it. There's no one solution for anyone, but we do see a lot of challenges for people who tried to get too illiquid. So for example, if you already own a lot of real estate, you have your business, and you transition the business to something like a private equity fund or something that has a lockup, then suddenly at times like this, your pinch isn't that things are going down. Your pinch is that you don't have access to cash. And that's what we really want to emphasize is, what do you own? Can you access it? And if not, what are the barriers to entry? And making sure that you have adequate liquidity that goes there. But we think that there's great potential in real estate, both domestic and global. We think there's a lot of opportunity for growth in a number of industries in the United States. What we are cautioning against is, don't race too fast for safety or guarantees. Because if somebody's offering a guarantee, it's coming at a really high cost when fear is high. And now's not the time to be trying to catch a falling knife. Just be patient. These things there's going to be plenty of time to get in. You don't have to capture the bottom. There's going to be plenty of time to get in. But the opportunities to access the market are as wide as they've ever been.
Last week, the market tumbled, right? And then today, the Dow is up over 8% just today.
Right.
What do you see, like, in your crystal ball over the next week or month? And I know, like, it's the crystal ball because we don't know what's going to happen. There's so much uncertainty out there. And the uncertainty is really what is driving some of this from my limited knowledge in this, although I have been investing since I've been in high school. But right. But anyway, so the Dow up 8% today, everything tumbled last week. I'm guessing nobody knows, but if you had to give your best guess on like what you see happening over the next week or month, what's your macro view of everything?
So over the next week or month, that's so short term that we really just don't know the depth. I think here's a couple of trends that we're going to look for. One is moving from uncertainty, managing uncertainty, to managing risk. Uncertainty, we just have no idea what the conditions are. Once we get to managing risk, we know, okay, businesses are opening back at this rate. We have some data to work with. When there's no data, you see these big drop-offs like we saw last week. The other thing is we need some good news. We need some speed bumps. When we get fearful about our businesses, fearful about our finances, we start with this nugget of fear, and then we can race to the worst possible conclusions. When there's no good news to stand in the way or slow that down, things can get pretty hairy as they have been. I would expect over the next month, we start getting some positive news, some mitigation, and that's when things start to stabilize a little bit. But you're going to get days like two Fridays ago where if the market was up 2% at 3:30 and finished up 10 by 4 o'clock, it can be just as volatile to the upside as the downside. So we're doing some constructive things from a tax. There's a lot of tax loss harvesting you can do at these levels mm-hmm. for clients. There's a lot of proactive steps to make sure your safe stuff is safe and your aggressive stuff is still going to grow. So we've been very active, not selling out of the market, but making sure that when it comes back, we own the right stuff.
That's good. And the certainty piece of that is critical because there's just so much unknown right now. So even if it's bad news, you know, like this thing's going to last a certain period of time, you know, once we kind of understand that certainty, is that drive stability to the market?
I think it does. And the example I would give is, I think it was Friday afternoon, Goldman Sachs came out and said, the economy is going to decline by 25% in the second quarter. And the market didn't move. Mm-hmm. Because it was already expecting that that was going to be about the decline. And the irony of that is, if the market only declines by 18%, then that means a big up move because it's not as bad as expected. So I think that's, we always talk about, it's not whether, when you're investing, it's not whether the things are bad or good. It's whether they're getting better or getting worse.
Yeah. So a lot of people out there, they're getting their reliable information from NBC, CNBC, Fox, and CNN, whatever their favorite channel of choice is. What, I'm guessing, like, that's not your main source of information. Like, I'm getting emails with like McKinsey Consulting and, you know, and then some of the big real estate firms and CB Richard Ellis and what they're putting out. Where are you getting information that the general public also has access to it? Like, where would you be relying on good information?
So along with kind of the democratization of investments, where the cost of investing has come way down and the access to investing, same thing has happened with information. So it used to be that you had to go to the ivory tower to get research reports from investment banks. Over the last 10 years, really since the financial crisis, some of the best minds about finance and investing are now, they're running their own blogs. They're running their own boutique advisory firms and investment firms. So the writing, I'd be happy to share with you a list of some of the sources that I use. But for me, I'm very attuned to turning off the television during the day. I don't have one in my office. So I have certain podcasts that I listen to on a regular basis, mostly around core principles of investing. They put the context of the day around it, but a lot of it is based on core principles. And a lot of the writing I do is long form analysis. So it's really taking a lot of perspective. The quick hits that you get on CNBC and Bloomberg, it's not terribly constructive. A lot of it's headline driven. So if I'm doing my reading at the end of the day, it helps me to say, all right, this was the story in the journal this morning. This was relevant. This was not. And it helps me to keep my filter pretty strong Yeah. for what's actually meaningful.
I like that. I like the filter to be able to, you have the filter so you know what to do with the flashy headlines that you see,
right?
Because all these headlines are meant to get us to click to read it. That's all it is.
Yeah. We're big believers in behavioral finance, that a lot of times our biggest enemies when it comes to making good financial decisions are our own biases and the baggage that we all bring to financial decisions. My wife and I talk about it all the time. Her experience with money is very different from mine, and we have to talk openly about that. Mm-hmm. And I don't think the constant media deluge is helpful if you're going to try and overcome some of those behavioral challenges.
I love it. I want to let you go. I don't want to keep you too long. Any last bits of wisdom for the franchisees and franchisors listening?
I think we always approach financial planning with the idea of maximum flexibility. I think if you're planning for anything, whether you're getting into a new franchise model, whether you're thinking about exiting, always think, how many decision points do I have along this path? If I can have an option to off-ramp here, there, and down the line, then that's going to give you the most strength to your plan. So, you know, as you're thinking things through, build in flexibility, keep your liquidity, and then it helps you to manage through times like this.
Excellent advice. It'll be interesting to see where we are in a year from now, but I think there's going to be a lot of good news ahead for a lot of people that are making really good decisions. I wish I would have been able to get into more of the decision-making process with you. Maybe that's another time, but
anytime.
I really appreciate you coming on and sharing. How can people find you?
You can reach me at our website, MortonBrownFW.com or dmorton@mortonbrownfw.com.
And we'll put that in the show notes as well.
All right. Thanks so much. Appreciate it, Eric.
Yeah, thank you.
Thanks for listening to this episode of the Franchise Secrets Podcast. Whether you're watching or listening, please make sure to subscribe to my YouTube channel and to whatever channel you're listening on. If you want my help with anything from buying a franchise to franchising your business, please visit franchisesecrets.com.